Welcome the Holy Spirit, welcome the Lord, come into his presence with thanksgiving, into its course with praise. Father, thank you so much for all you have done. Give you the praise and the glory. We thank you that this is a special Sunday, Lord, that we are doing some baptisms today, Lord, which is such an amazing thing. I'm excited about that. And Lord, I just praise you and I just thank you that your mercies are new every morning, and that we can always expect something new from you, something amazing, Lord, from your hand. You are good. You are good to your children, and worthy of praise. Hallelujah.
Glory. things that were not pretty places. Let's talk about Job. Not Job. No, yeah, Job too. But there's all these things that we expected to be this, if you will, hallmark moment. And God sees us in our worst moments. He comes to us in our messes. He comes to us when everything around us is chaos. And he might even say, you need to go eat something, go take a nap, and then we'll talk. Or he might send somebody to you. Or he might release you from your prison that you have been in that nobody else knows about. He doesn't expect it to be perfect picture. He comes to you, and he will never forsake you.
Not for.
Some of us here, Lord, who are waiting for something before we finally turn to you. We're waiting for the pressure to be released. We're waiting for that Holy Spirit moment. Whatever it is, we have it in our mind that we're waiting for you when you're waiting for us. And so, Lord, for whoever that's for today, I'm just going to lead us in a prayer. Lord, we commit to taking action. We commit to listening to the Holy Spirit. We commit to seeking you. We are not going to wait for the perfect day. We are not going to wait until the end of the season. We're not going to wait till the end of the month. We are going to take Holy Spirit-led action today.
Yes, God.
We commit, Lord,
yes,
to seeking after you and committing our lives to you, committing our difficulties to you, to trusting you, Lord. And we ask that you would give us courage so that we can follow through with whatever it is that you're speaking to us today. I believe, Lord, that you are speaking to us right now in this moment. There's some of us who have been putting things off. We know what we need to lay down. We know what we need to do. Maybe it's an addiction. Maybe it's just our own pride, our own self-will. Maybe it's time that we lay down our anger. Whatever it is, Lord, I believe there's people in here who know. They have their, in their mind's eye, even as I say this, they know what it is that they need to lay down. So we commit to doing that right now in Jesus' name. We ask for the courage to lay these things down at the foot of the cross. And we receive your forgiveness. We receive your redemption. In Jesus' name, amen.
So the thought in the song, this last song, was key. Always something about it every week that it's a home run. The Lord is in this place. And sometimes you get tired of hearing, you know, we go away. The church sends people away a couple times a year. And we just spent the 2 weeks in Ukraine. And trust me, the Lord is in the place over there. And it's the same Lord that's right here in this house. And you know, we were able to visit gypsy churches, Ukrainian churches, alcoholic homes. God was there everywhere we went. And that's just a wonderful thing. Good morning, church. Good to see everybody. It's good to be home. When you walked in this morning, I actually came in the back door, so I don't even know who was giving away Connect cards today, but someone was handing you out Connect cards, I'm sure. And if you're a regular attender, you know what to do with it. If you're a visitor, if you want to tear that stub off the bottom, maybe fill that out. And right on the other side of the sound booth in the lobby is a little connection area. There'll be someone there that can greet you after service, answer any question that you have. There's a little basket you can put this stub in. And then Pam will take care of that and get prayer requests and praise reports out to the leaders on Monday. And it just allows us to keep in touch with you and know what's going on. So make use of that card. As we move on in our worship this morning, we're going to take our offering. And just right before we get ready to take an offering, I just want to make a statement. When Tom and the group and us, we went over in the spring and we took money from you, from the church, to buy that house over in the Ukraine by the church, missions, and I'm telling you, they are full bore going with that house. They've done some remodeling in it. They're changing fences. They're getting ready to put up a children's recreation area. And that's partially from what you give into this church, into our world missions. So, Father, I just thank you for allowing us to participate with you. It's good when we can see fruit. I mean, we see fruit every week here with what goes on in this building and the hub and the ministries of the church. And Lord, just you allow us to have this building. We thank you for that. So Father, we just, say that it's an honor to be a partner with you. And you just take our offerings and our tithes, Lord, and you breathe on them. And it's amazing to see what your breath can do to a penny. And it just explodes it. So we give you thanks for allowing us to be a part of your endeavor in this world. And it's all in Jesus' name that we're thankful. So, amen. Okay, as the deacons take the offering, there is a baptism going to be here today. After John's message during worship, we have a young man going to get baptized. And then there's some Nepalis going to get baptized this afternoon, so that's a great thing. Women of the Bible class starts this Tuesday, the 24th, at 1 o'clock in room 101. And Joe Saunders is leading it, so if you have any questions, see Joe. Next Sunday, the 29th, is Shakeout Sunday. So we'll have some buckets up here, and you can partake in our missions outreach. And you'll probably have a message next week, right? Meeting. There'll be a missions meeting in the back next Sunday. We'll announce it. The Portage County Home Group, we're back in service on this tomorrow, on the 23rd. We kind of took a little hiatus for the fair and stuff like that, but back at it. The Lord says, come on, let's get together. And if you have, you know, there's rolling things on the screen, especially out front, all the time. So pay attention to those, because those are the ongoing things that are going on all week. So Tom, you got a couple things or got something to say here?
Yeah. Morning, everyone. I've got good news and I've got bad news. How many of you know this is an election year? John says, is that the good news or the bad news? Well, it's both, actually. The bad news is the annoying ads that are flying around. The good news is that God has ordained this nation to elect its leaders by the will and the consent of the people. That's amazing. That's great news. Now, here's another little tidbit of bad news. You may not know this, but only on average about 30% of evangelical Christians even bother to vote. How many of you think the country is headed in the wrong direction? If you have your hand up, God help you. You're part of the solution, or you're part of the problem. You've got to get out there and vote. You've got to get out there. I'm not telling you how to vote, but I am telling you, vote and vote your values. Vote your biblical values. Now, if you're not registered to vote, that registration closes October 7th. So we've set up a little booth right outside here in the inner lobby. When you walk out, it's on the right-hand side. You can register today. You're going to be able to do this the next 3 Sundays. You can register to vote. You may be thinking, registering to vote in church? I went down to the Board of Elections and I picked up 50 applications, and they're thrilled that you're doing this. So this is a good thing. But you're not going to be able to vote if you do not register. And while you're out there, our own Bruce Gentner has produced a really excellent little paper on what it means to vote your Christian values. He just gives several topics there and what Christian conservative values are. And then it's interesting, on the flip side, the secular humanist values are almost completely opposite. And so vote your values. Amen. So if you haven't registered to vote, please do so. Please do so. You've got this Sunday, next. Yeah, please do that. And we'll be glad to help you. Just fill it out. It won't take you 60 seconds. We'll make sure that you get that it gets back to the Board of Elections. And anything else? Okay, we're going to release the children now to their classes. Or are we doing the baptism first? No. Okay, releasing the kids. Greet one another. Welcome them to the house of the Lord.
If you can find your seats. I had a what I thought was a pretty good list. I had what I thought was a pretty good list of jokes to share with you guys, but I left it at home. So, but I do have one memorized that I thought was pretty funny that I can share with you. So I'm pretty convinced that I can just look at somebody and tell whether or not they're judgmental. That's a good one, right? I like jokes. Simplicity. So I was reading, I was preparing for this message today, and I came across something in Christianity Today, which is definitely not a joke. And with my sense of humor, it's really hard to tell. I'm like being serious. This one is not a joke. It's actually kind of heart-wrenching. It's kind of sad. It was a pastor who had been serving his church for about 8 years. And he had gotten to that place in serving when he was experiencing what I would call extreme burnout, specifically related to compassion. And so here's what he writes in Christianity Today. He says, 2 years ago, I nearly ditched my job as a pastor. I started focusing on the negatives of my job, the Saturday night sermon anxiety attacks, a pitiful raise that I got after 8 years, the disintegrating basement tiles in the basement. And after 8 years of frantically meeting the needs of the congregation, people-pleasing, tracking down plant stands for weddings, I could identify only trace elements of spiritual growth in my congregation. A dangerous ice spread throughout my heart, an ice of cynicism, the ice of pastoral sloth, an attitude that didn't really care if people changed anymore because they didn't really want to change anyway. And while I prayed for an escape from that job, the Lord instead resurrected my call to ministry during our family vacation in Montana. While I was reading and praying on an elementary school park, three children came up to me wearing dirty clothes, dirt-streaked faces, and they plopped themselves on the grass next to the bench I was sitting on. Before I could object or move, the oldest child launched into a complicated story of family dysfunction. "Hi, my name is Diana," she said. "I'm 12. My sister, this is my sister Christy, she's 10. And my brother Mikey, doesn't he look fat in that Lion King shirt? He's 6. Actually, though, we all have different dads. My dad is dead. Christy's dad disappeared. Mikey's dad beats him, so our mom is divorcing the guy. My mom and her new fiancé, Larry, are at the casino now because they need some time alone. So she bought us one barbecue burrito and told us to stay in the park for 2 hours. Can we sit by you?" In order to be polite, I said yes. Then I asked if they lived in town. "No," Deanna said. "We used to live in town, but my mom lost her job. I don't like living in a tent. By the way, what's your job?" "I'm a pastor," I said. After a long silence, she said, "Mr. Pastor, can you tell me something? I've heard stories about Jesus walking around healing people and loving them. Why doesn't he do that anymore?" It was at that moment the Lord reminded me of why I committed myself to serving his people. How did God rebuild my call to ministry? He broke my heart again for the love of these three kids. I can tell you, I practiced that probably 5 or 6 times. That's the first time I got through it without tears in my eyes. In the brief time that I've been a senior pastor, I admit that ministry in a church setting doesn't go as fast as I would have wished. Sometimes things go a little bit slower. And if we're being honest, each one of us who has been diligent in our serving the Lord, our commitment to serve him, We all come to the table with preconceived ideas, a lens by which we view the world, even our own judgments of others when they aren't responding to the gospel the way that we think they should. And maybe that lens has been developed through somewhat legitimate experiences. They cause us, unfortunately, to become jaded and numb to the suffering of people around us, even going so far as to think that they deserve or have earned their suffering due to their own actions. I know I've been there. Let's be honest. I've been there. Maybe I'm the only one. But the Lord has a beautiful way of encountering us in just the perfect way to help us swap out our jaded, numb, judgmental lens with the lens of the Holy Spirit so that we can better step into compassionate ministry that is supposed to be the trademark of the Christian faith. This is who we are. This is who Jesus was. And this is who he wants us to be. Amen? Let's pray. Lord, we come here today. We know that you say to us, come as you are. But you want us to leave changed. You want us to leave closer to you. And so, Lord, we embrace that. We do not want to leave here the same way as when we came in. For those who are wearing our own jaded lenses, Lord, we pray that you would break that in Jesus' name. Break it off of us. Give us a compassionate heart. Help us to see the world around us and the suffering around us, Lord, and give us the courage to do something about it. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, a month or so ago, I began a 5-part series in Vineyard Values. And after taking a detour for the last couple of weeks, we're going to be picking up today in Vineyard Value number 4, engage in compassionate ministry. And we're continuing our journey through the book of Luke, and this week we're going to be finishing up chapter 8, starting in verse 40. Let's read. Now when Jesus returned, a crowd welcomed him, for they were all expecting him. Then a man named Jairus, a synagogue leader, came and fell at Jesus' feet, pleading with him to come to his house because his only daughter, a girl of about 12, was dying. Here we have an interesting scene. You know, word is starting to get around about Jesus. People actually know where he's going to go, and we don't know if that's because the disciples went ahead of him and sort of announced his coming. But people are starting to expect Jesus in certain places. And when he shows up, we have a crowd gathered. And here we have a synagogue leader who went to Jesus. Now, remember, the synagogue leaders were in general contentious about Jesus' ministry. Some of them were venomous and openly opposed his ministry. And others, like Jairus, it seems, were desperate enough to overlook some of that stuff. Undoubtedly, Jairus would have known about Jesus. In fact, that's why he came. And undoubtedly, he would have been warned by other Jewish leaders to stay away from Jesus. Undoubtedly, he would have probably had a lot of reservations in his heart. But how many of you know that when life gets real, most people, even the skeptics, decide that all of a sudden, turning to Jesus isn't that bad of an idea? How's the old phrase go? There's no atheists in a foxhole. When stuff gets real, a lot of people, even if they are skeptics, even if they oppose Jesus' message and Christians in the Bible, a lot of people all of a sudden realize, because deep in their heart they know he's the only one who can help them. He's the only one who can save them. And here we have a man whose only daughter, who's about 12, was not just a little sick. She was clearly dying. The scriptures say that she was dying. And no matter what this man might have heard or seen regarding Jesus, when there's a need for a miracle, all of that other stuff goes out the window. The man didn't care how his peers might look at him. He didn't care about his own reservations, his skepticism. Because when we need a touch of God, all that matters is seeking Him. All that matters is getting to Him, getting to the only one who we know can perform a miracle, getting to the only one who we know can save us. Maybe if I just touch the hem of His robe. It's exactly what the woman in the rest of the story says. Let's keep reading. As Jesus was on His way, the crowds almost crushed Him, and a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years, but no one could heal her. She came up behind Him and touched the edge of His cloak, and immediately her bleeding stopped. Just gently touched His garment and got healed instantly. "Who touched me?" Jesus asked. Moving on to verse 45. When they all denied it, Peter said, "Master, the people are crowding and pressing in on you, pressing against you." But Jesus said, "Someone touched me, and I know that power has gone out from me." Then the woman, seeing that she could not go unnoticed, came trembling and fell at His feet. In the presence of all the people, she told why she had touched Him and how she had been instantly healed. Then He said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace." So there's definitely some similarities between these two stories, these two accounts. And we're going to finish reading about Jairus in a second, but Jesus was on His way to Jairus' house, and then all of a sudden, there was somebody in need, and He stopped. Both of these people were extremely desperate. Both of them knew that in times of desperation, the only one who could help was Jesus. Maybe there's some of you guys here. Maybe you guys can relate. You're going through something. Maybe it's a physical health issue. Maybe it's some kind of an addiction. Whatever it is, you've tried time and time again to fix this problem. You've tried time and time again to fix this emotional issue. You've tried time and time again to fix this financial issue. You've tried and you've tried in your own strength over and over and over. Maybe for 12 years. You've tried to fix this about yourself, this character defect, whatever it is, this addiction. My suggestion to you is that you do whatever it takes to touch the hem of His robe. You do whatever it takes to get His attention. Now, we know that Jesus and God are everywhere, but there are some places and there are some times in our walk with Him in which He wants us to step out of our comfort zone, to seek Him, to go out of our way, to position ourselves to get closer to Him. C.S. Lewis says that the Lord whispers to us in our pleasure and screams at us in our pain, meaning that oftentimes the Lord will allow pain in our lives. He will allow suffering in our lives to get our attention, to get us to a place of repentance, to get us so that we are willing to do anything to draw near to Him, to touch the hem of His robe. And can I just mention something? You know, there's lots of different ways that we can draw near to Him. I mean, there really are. Spiritual disciplines, spiritual practices. I could stand up here, I could spend the rest of my time preaching on, hey, here are some ways to get close to the Lord. But as I was praying about this message, I really felt like the Lord wanted me to highlight one specific spiritual discipline that actually, I believe, especially in our culture, in this day and age, rises above some of these other spiritual disciplines. One of the most powerful things that we can do to draw near to the Lord is fasting. And it's something that, for whatever reason, our culture almost refuses to do. I don't know what it is about fasting that makes it work, but I do know that in a culture that seems to glorify and justify obesity, barely even recognizing gluttony as a sin, it is no surprise that the enemy wants to convince us that fasting isn't healthy, it's legalism, or that it's dangerous. Why would the enemy want to tell us that? Because he wants us to do anything but fast. The enemy does this because he knows how powerful it can be. And this message isn't about fasting. I don't want to spend too much time on here, but I want to tell you that if you want to draw near to the Lord, if you're desperate enough to just draw near to him, do you want to touch the hem of his garment? How badly do you want to be healed? How badly do you want to be set free? How bad would life need to get for you to decide, I'm going to give up eating for 24 hours? Moving on. I love what Jesus does, though, in this exchange. Because you have to understand the context of what's really going on with this woman. See, the problem that this woman had was very specific. This is why Luke records it, I believe. The problem was bleeding, which in that time, and we don't know what it was, you know, we don't know how or where she was bleeding, but we do know that in that time, if you had an issue like this, in Jewish law, in the Torah, and even all these sort of extra biblical laws that they made up, if somebody had a bleeding issue, they were ceremoniously unclean. And in many cases, this person, if they touched you, if they grabbed your arm or your hand, you then became ceremoniously unclean in their eyes, which meant that you had to go through days or even sometimes a week of ritualistic purification and all these different rituals, and you had to live outside of the city. There's all these different things that you had to do if a person like that even touched you. And because of her problem, she was an outcast in Jewish society. Many cities wouldn't let people like this even in the city walls. And she would have been known by the people. And she suffered tremendously. But you know, when you're desperate enough, you don't really care about the law. You don't really care about the rules anymore. See, she had the slightest glimmer of hope. Sometimes that's what we need. We just need the slightest glimmer of hope. She had the slightest glimmer of faith. He didn't say that her faith was like that of a mountain. He said, your faith has healed you. She wondered if just maybe, this Jesus might be able to heal her. But the compassion to overlook her transgression and the law was what makes this story unique. See, Jesus didn't do what she expected he would do. What she expected, and this is why she did it in secret. This is why she kind of didn't want anyone to know what she was doing. What she expected was if people knew that she had touched Jesus, she expected him as a leader, because this is how all the other Jewish leaders had treated her probably for 12 years. She expected to be outcast. She expected to be publicly shamed, publicly humiliated. This is what she expected from Jesus. Not because she knew him necessarily, but because that's how everybody else had treated her. But what does he do? He doesn't do any of that stuff. He raises her up into her true identity. He calls her daughter. That's not just some, you know, when I talk to my kids, call my son my daughter, I'm raising them up to a place that is near and dear to my heart, a place of high status in my household. And that's what he does to her. He calls her daughter. And he commends her publicly rather than shaming her publicly. She expected to be shamed, but instead, she was raised publicly and commended in front of everybody. This is a perfect example of how the kingdom works. This is how the Lord interacts with us today, still. He interacts with us to raise us up into our new identity. When we fall into some sort of shortcoming or sin, or, you know, we allow ourselves to be tempted this way or that, the Lord never approaches us with shame or public humiliation. He's never as concerned with the laws or the proper customs or even our own sin over the value that he places in relationship. It's not the rules that prevent sin. It's the relationship that prevents sin. And God knows this and Jesus knows this, which is why if you ever come before, you come to church and there's somebody, you're confessing something to somebody and they, you know, either publicly shame you or they make you feel like an outcast, like you're not welcome, you're not in the right place. You need to be able to be in a safe place to confess whatever it is that you're going through, to be raised into your new identity. That's why it's so important. It's so important that we understand this in this church. Because every church is going to have sin. It's just a question of how we deal with it. If we try to force sin to go away by rule of law, it will only make it get worse. Because it'll go underground, and nobody will talk about it, and nobody will really be walking in freedom. God never approaches us as a disappointed father, putting our sin on display to shame us, in some misguided attempt to force us to be perfect. Instead, the first thing that he does is he offers us unconditional relationship, no conditions. He does not expect you to come into church perfect. He does not, hey, you come here as you are, and you leave here changed. You come here as you are. The Lord wants, first and foremost, a relationship with you. Nothing else matters until that relationship is secure, until that relationship is established. And it's through this relationship that he will begin to lovingly address any sin that we might be struggling with. And throughout the entire process, this process of addressing sin, it's what we call sanctification. That's what theologians call sanctification. He always approaches us in the same manner that he approached this young woman, with love, compassion, and a supernatural patience, focusing on the relationship to help us decide in our own free will to lay down the sin that is catching us up, the sin that's actually hurting us. He wants to change us from the inside out. He doesn't want to approach us with some sort of heavy-handed law or rule. He wants to love us where we are, how we are, who we are. And out of that relationship, out of that love, we decide that actually that sin just isn't really tempting anymore. I'd rather be near and dear to the Father. I'd rather spend time with the Lord than engage in anything that is less than that. It's actually the most brilliant way of getting people to change their hearts. And I gotta say, as Christians, if you want somebody to change their mind about something, it's probably a pretty good model to follow, isn't it? Like, for example, consider our political climate. If we want to change somebody's mind, what do you think is more effective? Telling them they're wrong, telling them that here's all of the steps that you, this is why you're wrong, trying to use logic and reason with people who are emotionally invested into this or to that. Is that going to help sway their vote if you feel like, hey, I'm worried about this person is going to not vote the way that I think they should. I'm worried about this person is not going to vote biblical values. Should I just tell them what they're doing wrong? Or should I invite them into a relationship, an unconditional relationship, loving them exactly where they're at, spending time with them exactly where they're at? And through the course of that relationship, they become intrigued. They want to know why you think the way that you think. And then all of a sudden, it's the relationship that opens them up to a changed vote. Now, it may be a little too late for this election, because relationship sometimes takes time. It could be 6 months of just spending time with somebody before they trust you enough to actually listen to you. But I implore you, this is the best way, not just to change an election, but to actually spread the gospel. If you want to evangelize, if somebody you know is not a Christian, you have a family member who is venomously opposed to Christianity, don't talk about Christianity every single time you see them, telling them they're wrong. Don't talk about all the things that you think that they're doing, their sin, this, that. Just be in relationship with them. Love them. Show them that not all Christians are judgmental in that way. And meet with them for a year, 2 years, and eventually they'll know that you really do love them. And hopefully you do. And that opens them up to the gospel. We've got to keep this in mind, guys. If you want to change hearts and minds, it always occurs through the relationship. That's how Jesus does it. That's how God does it. That's how God got all of us. And if you want to evangelize, if you want to affect change in the world, you want to see people having a personal relationship with Jesus, just spend time with them. Get to know them. Be committed, one person at a time, to loving people to a place of helping them to open their hearts up to the possibility of the gospel. Amen? After this story with the bleeding woman, the story takes a little bit of a twist. Let's finish our reading out for the day, starting in verse 49. While Jesus was still speaking, someone came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader. "Your daughter is dead," he said. "Don't bother the teacher anymore." Hearing this, Jesus said to Jairus, "Don't be afraid. Just believe, and she will be healed." When he arrived at the house of Jairus, he did not let anyone go in with him except Peter, John, and James, and the child's mother and father and mother. Meanwhile, all the people were wailing and mourning for her. "Stop wailing," Jesus said. "She is not dead, but asleep." They laughed at him, knowing that she was dead. But he took her by the hand and said, "My child, get up." Her spirit returned, and at once she stood up. Then Jairus told them to give her something to eat. Her parents were astonished, but he ordered them not to tell anyone what had happened. Twice now, we have situations back to back in which most of the people at the time either turned away, shamed, mocked, or laughed at people who were desperate for a touch from the Lord. People who were undeserving, sinful, and following the rules and not following the rules and the customs of the culture. And Jesus met them exactly where they were at, without judgment, without shaming them, without any expectations from them. And he allowed them to come before him exactly as they were. They did not need to be perfect. And he offers them that which nobody else can offer. And I'm not talking about a healing. I'm talking about compassion. He offers them compassion. Nobody else in those crowds was offering these two people compassion. They were mocking at them, laughing at them, ostracizing them. It's not even the healing to me that is the most miraculous thing here. The most miraculous thing is that Jesus goes against the culture and offers compassion to the outcasts. The Vineyard value for this week is engaging in compassionate ministry. Let's see what Vineyard writes about this. In parentheses, I added that. I hope you don't mind. It's not actually in the Vineyard value. "We lean towards the lost, the poor, the outcast, and the outsider with the compassion of Jesus as former sinners, whose only standing before God is utterly dependent on the mercy of God. This mercy can only be truly received inasmuch as we are willing to give it away." Boy, think about that for a minute. His mercy for you can only truly be received inasmuch as you are willing to give it away. Now, it's not like an absolute theological statement, but if you think about it from that perspective, the more that you give mercy to others and compassionate ministry to others, the more you will actually be able to see the full breadth of the mercy that's offered to you. It's probably a better way of stating it. "We believe that ministry in Jesus' name should be expressed in concrete ways through the local church. The poor are to be served as though serving Jesus himself. This is one of the distinguishing characteristics of a church expressing the love of Christ in a local community." This is the hallmark of the Christian heart. How many of you guys have ever served in the Hub? Amen. Praise God. If you're not raising your hand, I don't want to judge you into serving there, you know. But to be honest with you, you're missing out. It really is a beautiful ministry. And there's many ways to serve the poor. There's many ways to do outreach and all those things. But I'm so thankful for Chris and so many others who have so faithfully served in that ministry. Bob, I know there's just so many here who have been involved in that ministry for years. Pastor Allen, I'm just so thankful for you guys. It's not because it like makes us good, you know, to the outside community. And it's not even because I think that it's important that we serve others. It's actually because of what it does for the people who actually take the time to serve in that ministry. That ministry has helped to mature this church. And I'm so thankful for you guys. I would encourage you, if you want to draw near to the Lord, if you are seeking His mercies, consider serving in a ministry like The Hub or The Hub. Moving on. In all forms of ministry, compassion is the hallmark of the one who was moved with compassion himself in the face of human need. This being the age of grace and the year of the Lord's favor, from Luke 4:19, compassion should constitute the leading edge of our service to God, each other, and a broken world. As such, we seek to avoid unauthorized judgments of others, realizing that we are fellow sufferers and strugglers with the rest of humanity. The key to serving others in Christ's name is found in this last paragraph. The foundation of it all is compassion. Now, I understand that there are times when I serve others because I know that it's the right thing to do, or sometimes I serve out of obedience to the Lord. But in general, service of others should have at its very core, the very foundation of why we're motivated to do it, we should have compassion, no matter what the other person's circumstances are. And many of us have been serving for a very long time in the same roles. And I got to tell you, if you're serving in a role without compassion, now again, every now and then we have bad days, we have bad weeks. I'm talking about the majority of the time. If you're serving without compassion 40, 50% of the time, 60% of the time, I would strongly encourage you to take a step back. Spend some time with the Lord. Recharge, rest if you need to rest, refocus, and pray and ask Him for the gift of compassion again. Because it's not good for you and it's not good for others. The fruit of serving other people without compassion at its core is burnout, contempt, self-righteous judgment. Even if it's the same action, if my heart is not motivated and moved to love, then it's from the flesh, not the spirit. Whereas service with compassion is from the spirit. I also love the last sentence in this value because it actually tells us how to embrace compassion for others, mainly that we recognize the truth of ourselves, especially outside of the changing power of the gospel. Sometimes, you know, we've been saved for so long that we forget what it was like before we knew Him. To be put more simply, but for the grace of God, there go I. That's the truth. The truth is that if I didn't have the grace of God, there is no limit. There's no bound to the sin that I probably wouldn't have eventually engaged in. And if you're saying to yourself, no, that could never, you know, I would never do stuff like that. Or if you're approaching somebody with this idea that I'm better than they are, or I would never do something like that. Friend, it's time to ask the Lord to change your heart. It's time to ask the Lord to see the truth about yourself. Some of you have maybe felt that creeping into your heart at times. But I want to tell you, I spent some time in prayer this week, and I believe the Lord gave me to actually a very simple solution for how you can change your heart. Get yourself back to a spirit of compassion for people. If you find that you're struggling to maintain compassion to the lost, or even those professing the name of Christ, one of the most powerful things that we can do is commit to serving them. It goes right back to the story that I began the service with. When we get out of our comfort zone, we get out of our echo chamber, and we begin to interact with people who are less fortunate than us, we slowly begin to realize that everything that we have, even our own salvation, is a gift from God. The problem is that so many of us spend time with people who are just like us. And there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, I like my friends because we have shared values, shared goals, shared vision even for the church. I'm not saying that there's anything wrong with that at all. But if you haven't spent time with those less fortunate than you, if you've never been to Ukraine, I'm so thankful for some of the new folks who have been starting to go on some of these missions trips. I mean, for me, that was such a mind-blowing experience. I went in 2009, and I'm going into this village where they don't even have running water. They have mud brick, like mud floors. There's no road. There's no insulation in their houses. They have like fires. And you know what they do during winter? They take stones and they put the stones around the fire and then they wrap them up in their beds to keep warm so they don't die. They don't have enough food. They're getting dysentery because they don't understand the simple science that we take for granted. They don't understand that they can't be putting an outhouse next to the stream that they're drinking from. It's experiences like that, spending time with those that are not even less fortunate than us. They're third world. They're living in a world 1,000 years ago. Can you love them right where they're at? Can you cuddle them and pray with them, knowing that you're probably going to get fleas or some other whatever? Will you do that? It's stuff like that that ignites your heart for compassion again. Serving those less fortunate than us actually positions us for a greater level of appreciation and gratitude for what we have. Not just materialistically, but spiritually as well. If you sit here today, having repented and received the free gift of grace, full of the Holy Spirit, you are spiritually rich. Let me say that again. This is like if you have heard the gospel and you have received it in your heart, you've repented of your sins, and you've received God's forgiveness, and you're full of the Holy Spirit, you are spiritually wealthy. It's time to share some of that wealth with those who are spiritually poor. Consider those who are so spiritually bankrupt that they would leave their own kids at a park to go gambling. You may think that that story is far away, but it's not. It absolutely is not. It's been a while since we've done this, but a few years ago, we were passing out groceries across the street. Across the street. I'm not talking about like up the road, around the corner, across the street. We knocked on a door, and reluctantly, two kids opened the door. They were maybe 7, 9. They were left home alone. They didn't know who we were, if they should even open the door for us. And we left them groceries. We asked them if we could pray for them, and they said no. They didn't know what that was. The parents had left them home alone. It's across the street, guys. Now I'm going to invite the worship team to come up, and I got to be honest with you. I struggled with how to end this message, you know? I wrote it and rewrote it, I think, 3 times. And my heart in trying to end this message was I wanted to stir this congregation to a place of compassion, but not just compassion in words or lip service, but compassion that is marked by action. What can I do? And then I realized, I can do nothing. I can't change your hearts. I can't get you out of your comfort zones. I can't motivate you. I'm not a motivational speaker. But here's what I can do. I can lead us in prayer to the one who can change your hearts. Amen. Let's stand and let's pray for a moment. Holy Spirit, come. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank you for what you did on the cross. We thank you that you took our punishment, you took our sin upon you. You embraced the cross and you did it out of love. But you didn't do it just for us, Lord. You did it for everybody. You did it for everybody. Help us to see the world outside of our bubble. Help us to see the world outside of our little box. Help us to have compassion on those less fortunate than us. Not just materialistically, but help us to have compassion for those who are spiritually bankrupt, who are lost, Lord. If not for your grace, there go I. And I don't know why you saved me. I don't know why you saved us, Lord, other than you love us. Why am I here and not there? I don't know, except that now I have a responsibility to carry your word to the lost, to give out of my riches, both materialistically and spiritually. I carry that responsibility, and Lord, I ask that you would help me to honor it. You've given me the responsibility of carrying your message of reconciliation, of hope and love. And I pray, even as in the quietness of our hearts, that you would speak to each one of us what we can do to love others in your name, to extend our riches to so many people who are spiritually poor, even physically poor, Lord. Put it on our hearts and then give us the courage to follow through with loving your people in the same way as if we were loving you yourself. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's worship the Lord together.
I'm a child.
our spirit. No longer are we slaves to the flesh, slaves to sin. We live by the Spirit. And the Lord Jesus commanded us, as an outward representation of what took place in the spiritual realm, He commanded us to do something called baptism in the natural, in the physical. Now, this isn't one of those things that, you know, if you don't get baptized, you're not saved. That's not a thing. Okay? But it is important, because not only did Jesus get baptized, but He commanded us to preach to all the nations and to baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And so today we are incredible. Everyone in here, we are blessed and honored to participate in the baptism of Chris Jules. Now, before I call him up, he's going to come up. He's going to share a few words. Before I call him up, I want to remind you that we are not spectators in something like this. We may watch him get baptized, but what it means for a congregation is that we are now committing to seeing him as a new creation. We are committing to see him and to view him in his new identity. The old is gone, the new has come. We are, as a congregation, aligning ourselves with Scripture. So what does that mean? It means that for anybody who's been baptized in Christ, it means that we as a family commit, anytime we see them stumble, anytime we see them not walking in their new nature, to gently, lovingly raising them into their identity in Christ, reminding them of who they are. They are a new creation. The old is gone, the new is gone. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Chris, come on up.
I just wanted to say a few things. First, just all the thanks and glory to God. My beautiful mom and dad, the rest of the family, the church family, everybody who prayed for me over the years. A little backstory. I put myself in a lot of bad positions and been places you couldn't believe, done things you probably wouldn't believe either. And God was just there with his hand out the whole time, like, come here, I got you. And I ran from it for years. I mean, I was running. I finally just decided one day, enough, you know, and I turned around and I run towards everything that I've been running from. And God got me, you know. It was definitely a thing. He has me. And I was walking on a trail about a month and a half ago and was talking to God, and he was like, it's time. You think so? And I said, yeah, I think it's time. So I signed up for the baptism, and here we are.
Thank you. an old tradition that when folks get saved or baptized, they're supposed to go and tell three people about Jesus that day. So I'm actually going to extend that invitation to everybody here. And I believe, honestly, this is no joke, I believe that there's going to come a spiritual blessing with that. If you go out of your way today to just let people know that Jesus loves them, whether you're at lunch or there's some friends or family, call somebody. Just reach out to them and just let them know that Jesus loves them. And I believe that's going to come with a spiritual blessing today and this week for everyone who does it. Amen. So, Lord, I pray that you would give us the courage, the words to say. Fill us with your Holy Spirit today. Give us the courage to get out of our comfort zone and give us the words to speak. Use us, Lord. We submit ourselves to you, and we ask that you would use us for your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
If you want prayer, come on up. We'd love to pray for you. Have a good week, everyone.